Listening effort is an important part of life for any person who uses a cochlear implant. This talk is about how effort is not the same as the percentage of words that a person hears correctly. But why would this not be true? Why not just think that more mistakes lead to more effort? After all, Adriana Zekveld showed that background noise levels that lead to lower performance consistently lead to higher effort. The problem is that this is true in the long run, but it doesn't help to explain what listening effort is and where it comes from. That is, we don't understand effort just by counting the mistakes. In the same way, there's a correlation between age and hearing loss, on a large scale, but this correlation, strong as it is, does not explain what hearing loss is. And more importantly, age by itself is not sufficient to know how much gain to supply with a hearing aid. In other words, as Tim Beachy says, we don't measure hearing loss just by asking a person's age. So to understand effort, we need to design experiments that don't just count mistakes. Because listening with a cochlear implant is not the same as normal hearing but with more mistakes, there are qualitative differences worth considering. Some of these include the need to compensate and recover from those mistakes, which might slow down your ability to respond fluently in conversation because you're still thinking about the last thing that was said. You could be extra vigilant for mistakes because you know they're going to happen, and therefore not be entirely confident about what was spoken. People will process and reprocess what they heard as they try to make sense of it. What we see is that people with cochlear implants will sometimes avoid conversations altogether if they feel that the effort is too much. And just as hearing loss isn't measured adequately by just measuring age, these aspects of communication are not measured adequately if we just count the number of mistakes a person makes when listening. We must consider the work that their brain is doing to piece together meaning from what they heard. But you might think that linguistic or cognitive factors aren't a central part of basic hearing sciences. And in fact, many studies attempt to remove the influence of language as much as they can. This is fine for times when we're measuring the ability to encode auditory information. But if we remove the influence of language, we're removing important things that affect listening effort in a realistic way, such as making meaning out of your perception, searching for coherence, predicting upcoming words, and revising your perceptions. These are skills that make someone a successful listener. To drive home this point, I'll make an analogy before getting into the data. Consider what makes someone a good driver. What would you measure? You could measure their ability to control the exact angle of their foot, obviously important because it controls the acceleration of the car. You could measure their ability to make fine motor movements with their arms to steer the car, obviously important to go the right direction. You could measure their visual acuity to make sure they can see the other cars on the road. But even if you measure all of these things, you won't really have a good sense of whether they're a good driver. For that, you'd want to know their ability to predict situations on the road, incorporate background knowledge, and anticipate what the other drivers are doing. They need to switch attention to various parts of the environment and be able to respond to unexpected and novel situations and find their way even when there's a detour. These aren't psychophysical abilities, but they're an essential part of the picture. And so it is also true for considering what makes a person successful at spoken communication. The basic auditory abilities are obviously necessary, but they're not sufficient for us to know whether someone will be a successful listener or if they will exert more or less effort. For that, we have to know how they handle unexpected challenges and contextual information, how they make sense out of the pieces of the message that they hear. For us to understand these things, a test of perception must offer the opportunity to sort through similar sounding and similar meaning options, and offer the listener a chance to go wildly in the wrong direction, to see the cost of unwinding the perception and getting it back on track. This experience might seem off-topic when discussing auditory perception, but it is the experience that is described by real people who have cochlear implants. Here we have a short anecdote by Sarah Sparks, who not only uses cochlear implants, but is an audiologist herself. Piecing words and sentences together from the bits that I catch is a regular part of my daily life. Deaf and hard of hearing people have to do this all the time, and after a few hours, it gets exhausting. There's a process of cycling through various alternatives until landing at one that makes sense. Dr. Sparks tells us that this process can be successful. She did figure out the right word, but it took her some effort to do it. There are lots of other really insightful descriptions of this in a great paper by Sarah Hughes. So we can see that effort is not just making a mistake, it's recovering from that mistake and handling the frustration and misdirection, deciding how hard you want to maintain the conversation. This is what we want to understand. To measure listening effort in the lab, we are tracking changes in pupil dilation as a person listens to speech. The participant looks at a screen and fixates on the red cross in the middle. They hear a beep, and then 2 seconds later, they hear a sentence. 2 seconds after the sentence, the cross turns green, and they repeat back what they thought they heard. The whole time, we're tracking the size of their pupils and how much they change as they listen. The data look like this. We see the three parts of the trial, the stimulus, the wait time, the response, and we're tracking change, so the zero line refers to the size of the pupil before the sentence. So we typically see a pattern like this that grows to a peak right as the sentence ends. And if we measure a different condition where it grows more, this is generally a sign that it was more effortful. There are some nuances to this interpretation. It can be complicated, but this is the general story. We're focusing on this time in between the sentence and the response, where the mental activity is strongest. A very important message I want to send here is that the nature of this research is not to simply place an eye tracker in front of a person and play some sounds and see how big the pupils get. If you want to understand where effort comes from, you need to ask specific questions, use specific stimuli designed to create a variety of experiences. And that's what we tried to do here, not just correlate things with effort, but explain where the effort comes from. In the next few minutes, I'll walk you through some studies that show that the number of errors in a sentence doesn't predict how effortful it was to hear, but effort is explained very well by the timing of a mistake and what type of mistake it was. That even correct responses could have still been effortful. There are situations where more mistakes can lead to less effort. And finally, perhaps the most important point, listening effort can be invisible to the outside world, so it takes some very intentional design to measure it and know how to manage it. Let's start first with the relationship between effort and the number of mistakes. Here we're showing the average proportional change in pupil size for 20 adults who wear cochlear implants, most of whom lost their hearing after acquiring spoken language, so postlingually deafened. When we observe one mistake in their response, we see an increase in pupil size, and if there were a linear relationship, we'd expect some kind of trend like this. But we don't see a trend at all, even counting up to 5 mistakes in the same sentence. Now, on average, there is an effect of having a mistake. We see larger dilation or more effort when there is a mistake compared to the trials with correct responses. The number you see there is the number of trials in each data point. But what really explains changes in effort is another factor entirely. These data points in blue are from trials where the participant's response was linguistically coherent. It made sense even if there were mistakes. But these data points up here are times where they could not make a sensible, coherent response out of their perception. And this is clearly making a big impact on the effort. It's not how many mistakes there were, it's whether the listener could construct meaning out of the perception. For example, if the sentence were, "The doctor prescribed the drug," and you said, "The doctor prescribed the pill," there's a mistake, but it still makes sense, and it doesn't demand a lot of extra effort. But if you responded with, "The doctor sighed the drug," there's no apparent meaning to the sentence, and it appears to demand more effort as the listener searches for resolution. What we're seeing is that effort doesn't just scale with the acoustic similarity of your perception and the target, the effort scales with your ability to resolve the meaning. Here are some other examples to make this point clear. If the sentence were, "His plan meant taking a big risk," and there was one mistake, "time" instead of "plan," or one mistake of misperceiving "the gambler" as "the gal who," even though it's one mistake, it's very effortful because there's no clear meaning to the sentence. Conversely, sometimes you see many mistakes at once, like these, but notice how these responses still have some coherent meaning, even if they're totally wrong. These kinds of responses are actually less effortful despite the larger number of mistakes. In fact, we see a surprising trend where no matter how many mistakes are made during the sentence, effort is reduced when the listener adds another mistake at the end of the sentence, presumably because that additional mistake was coherent with the first. We set up this plot to see how much context could reduce pupil size. If there's no effect of context, then you'd see the data right here at this red dashed line. But ideally, when you have context, you'd see a reduction of effort, So you'd see a negative change in pupil dilation in this area of the graph. And that's exactly what we saw for normal hearing listeners. Their data are below the zero line. But for listeners with cochlear implants, we see less of that reduction. This doesn't mean that they rely less on context. It means that when context is available, they don't enjoy as much of a reduction of effort. And that pattern doesn't change much when all of their answers are correct, as we see here. Now, when a cochlear implant listener gets the last word wrong in a sentence, it neutralizes the benefit of context. This is bad. But the last word in the sentence isn't the only place where a mistake could happen. If these listeners made a mistake on the words early in the sentence, we actually saw a trend in the data that we weren't even prepared for. It exceeded the top end of where we thought the data could go. So we had to change the scale of the y-axis to accommodate what happened. And what we see here is that if there's a mistake early in the sentence, which is to say a mistake on the contextual words, then the pupil dilates much more than if there were no context at all. So mistakes early in a sentence are much more costly than mistakes at the end of the sentence. Another important point to make here is that even when a person appears to have heard a sentence correctly, it still could have been effortful. Imagine that you thought you heard the glide, but by the time you hear the full sentence, you realize that that word was bride. If you repeat the sentence back, you say it correctly. The bride wore a long white dress. To the outside world, it's not evident that you made this little mental correction in your head. We just say, yeah, you got it correct. And so this is what helps to make listening effort invisible. We hear about this process all the time from people who have hearing loss. But how can we know if a person retroactively corrected a word in their head? We had to create sentences where this was not just a possibility, but a necessity. Here we have an example where you can see where the word of interest here is the word picture. So if we take that word and replace it with noise, you can still figure out what it was using later context. And these sentences were all carefully designed so that you couldn't predict the missing word, but you could restore it retroactively. And so if there's a correct word in that missing gap when they repeat the sentence, we know that you've done this mental correction in your head because we forced you to do it at a specific time and with specific language constraints. So this isn't measuring the effort of hearing speech and noise. It's the effort of having to go backwards and correct a word that you didn't hear right the first time. To orient you to the data, we have our trial events here, and the gray vertical bar is the time in between stimulus and response. We tested a group of 21 adults who use cochlear implants. When the full sentence was available, we get this pattern of pupil responses, but the question is what happened when they got a correct answer only after mentally correcting a missing word. In that case, this is the pattern that we see, a substantial increase in pupil dilation, which shows the extra effort of filling in that gap. For example, if you hear, they say you can't judge a book by its cover, but you actually repeat back the whole sentence, they say you can't judge a book by its cover. Then there are other cases when there's a mistake made, but the response still makes sense. Like if you hear, they say you can't judge a book by its cover, but you respond with, I saw that the book had a dusty cover. This is wrong, but it's still a sensible and coherent sentence. So we still get an elevated pupil response, and it's a little bit different than the responses we saw before. And finally, there are cases where the response is incoherent. Like if you say, they saw a judge being my cover. There's no meaning to this, and it's the most effortful situation that we saw. So we can learn a lot from this sequence of data. First, there's the effort of just listening to and understanding a sentence. Then there's the cost of fixing a misperception that happened along the way. There's an extra cost of generating a guess that wasn't constrained by the context. And finally, the cost of when you still have some ambiguity about the perception because it didn't make sense. So we can see clearly that even if the response is ultimately correct, that correcting misperceptions is effortful, and dealing with ambiguity is effortful. And now we ask, is it easy to tell when a person does this? Can a conversation partner detect when someone is exerting extra mental effort when listening? Here's how we find the answer to that question. Remember how during the experiment there were sentences that were fully intact and sentences with a word masked out, so the listener had to correct them in their head. The listeners heard the sentence and spoke their answers. We audio recorded their responses and played them back to new listeners who have normal hearing to see if they could detect which sentences were more effortful. They were given a full description of the situation, that they would hear talkers speak aloud a sentence that they either heard correctly or heard with a missing word that they had to fill in using context. And the listener's job was to judge this just based on the sound of the talker's voice. That's what we'll look at now. They indicated their ratings on a sliding scale, where 0 means the talker heard the full sentence, and 100 means that they think the talker had to fill in a missing word in their head. So if listeners were perfect at this, we'd see the data cluster at 0 on the left and 100 on the right. For the intact sentences, we do see the data points fall below the midpoint, which is promising. But unfortunately, the responses were just the same when the talkers had to mentally correct part of the sentences. So listeners were not really able to detect the extra effort in the person's voice. A summary of the results is here. As you can tell, there's a general bias to assume that the talker heard a full sentence and didn't have to mentally fill in any missing words, and there's basically no ability to differentiate these two situations. Something to note is that the listeners were given an equal number of recordings from each condition, and were explicitly told that they would hear half of one type and half of the other, and the recordings preserved the verbal reaction time of the talker, so we really tried to give them the information that they would need to succeed in this task. But as you can see, it was a real struggle. Since this is essentially a detection task, we calculated D prime to account for the bias of generally assuming more confidence in the talker's perception. Among all the different talkers, the D prime was very, very low, right around the mark where the score just indicates a complete guess. This is a sign that the talkers who use cochlear implants are not showing clear signs of effort through their voice, even though we tracked that effort in their perception. But this is an average performance from 179 listeners. Surely there could be some people who are better at detecting effort in a talker's voice. So along the way, we had the listeners respond to a series of questions about how they listen to other people's voices. For example, saying that they live with someone who has hearing loss, or saying that they're good at detecting uncertainty in a person's voice. We also specifically recruited audiologists to see if they might have an advantage. In this chart, we're seeing whether any of those attributes increases a listener's ability to detect effort in the voice of a person who uses a cochlear implant. So for example, if you're an audiologist, we should expect you to be very good at this, since you have experience with it, and we'd expect this line to go off to the right, which would be an increase in D prime. And it looks like there might be some patterns here, as you can see the number of people who are included in each group. But take a look at the scale. These are very small effects. And when we zoom out to a meaningful range, it's clear that these effects are so small that they're not making any meaningful impact. So the question, is anybody good at detecting effort in the voice? The answer is no. But to be fair, the study was conducted without the aid of visual cues and involved sentences that were not conversational in nature. But even including these limitations, these data are showing that it's difficult for a conversation partner to detect when someone with a cochlear implant is exerting extra effort when listening. So listening effort can be inaudible, and it can also be invisible. For example, consider this situation and how much effort this woman is putting into listening. It's so crowded and noisy in this restaurant that you might expect that she would exert a lot of effort in this situation, but it could also be that she's exerting no effort at all. Either because she's just nodding along and not even trying, or because she decided to stay home instead, because she would rather avoid the effort and the frustration. Effort can be hard to measure, because instead of struggling through difficult situations, people might simply change their behaviors. To recap, the data shown here suggests that even correct responses could have been effortful, because there could have been mental correction processes going on in a listener's head. Listening effort is explained very well by the type of mistake and when it happened during a sentence, but the absolute number of mistakes doesn't relate to effort directly. So we should not proceed with the idea that intelligibility is a proxy for listening effort. There are situations where more mistakes could lead to less effort, not because a person is giving up, but because they force coherence between unrelated words. And finally, the most important point, listening effort can be invisible to the outside world, for multiple reasons. One, it's hard to detect in a person's voice whether they executed these effortful mental processes. And two, instead of struggling with difficult, effortful situations, a person could simply not participate in conversation, making their effort and the person truly invisible. These are some of the challenges in front of us as we try to understand and improve the experience of those who use cochlear implants. Thank you for listening.